I know what you're thinking. Dr. J's vids usually deliver some sort of counter-mainstream political or medical message. Like the one about Orwell's classic 1984 as the most important read of today? Or natural immunity as far preferable to vaccine or drug therapy? Or maybe his take on the chiropractic subluxation? That must have ticked off some of his old school colleagues.
You think?
But salt? I mean, this one's a no-brainer, right? The experts say, get the shaker off the table. That stuff will kill us. So what's the doc gonna say here? Eat more?
Eat more.
30-something years ago, I'll never forget the day I was struggling with a particular patient. I was a rank rookie in applied kinesiology and chiropractic at the time, and my muscle testing results were sloppy, inconsistent. I was really frustrated with this guy. This was a fellow who had been religiously avoiding salt on the well-meaning warnings of his physician, and taking a chance, and with his permission, I sprinkled a little pinch of salt on his tongue. Now, I don't know which one of us was more stunned by the result. Several previously weak muscles to manual muscle testing became instantly strong as soon as the brain recognized sodium chloride on the tongue. Evidently, this triggered some kind of neurological on and off switch. It was just unbelievable. Now, this single case proved nothing, I agree, but certainly suggested that the mainstream's blanket admonition to completely shun salt for all people was at least unreasonable. This for sure was not going to be the last time I'd be testing salt going forward. And you know, patients kept strengthening with salt on the tongue. It was shocking to me, especially given the adamant anti-salt stance that the government and the medical world was taking at the time. Believe me, I was treading lightly with this stuff and for sure swimming against the medical establishment's anti-salt tide when I began recommending that patients start pulling their salt shakers back out of the cupboards and put them on the table. But they were starting to feel and function better. I saw improvements in blood pressure issues, irregular heartbeats, adrenal function, all by, yes, adding salt back to the diet. So imagine my delight now when in 2019 I found this book by Dr. James Dinicolantonio, The Salt Fix. Back to this in a second. So consider this analogy. With the exception of experienced yogis, perhaps, the respiratory rate of average adults in the world is about 16 breaths per minute. Mother Nature dialed that one in to deliver the appropriate volume of oxygen to lungs and tissues. Now, suppose suddenly the government came out and set new guidelines. They said, nope, 16 breaths a minute is too much, folks. We want you down to 10. Now, does that make sense to you? Obviously nonsense, right?
Hey, man, this was supposed to be about salt.
Yes, I know, and this is my point. Let me go to Dr. DiNicolantonio's book for a second.
I'll paraphrase. All humans left to unrestricted sodium consumption will tend to settle in at between 3 and 4,000 milligrams of sodium per day, a threshold we now know is the sodium intake range for optimal health.
Yeah, so?
So, the experts recommend 2,300 milligrams of sodium per day. That's about 75% of the low end.
For decades, health policy has been pinned to the theory, based on misrepresented research and poorly controlled studies, that humans need to disregard millions of years of Mother Nature's wisdom calling for more salt in favor of dumping salt off the table and out of the diet. Instead, we should consciously reduce our intake. Now, that make a lot of sense to you, given the countless competing interests when big politics, big pharma, big food, big money get together on any project. I'll take Mother Nature's innate wisdom any day of the week.
Remember the no-fat, low-cholesterol, high-carb diet mantra of the 70s, 80s, and 90s? How'd that work out for us? Explosion of diabetes and heart disease. That's how. The American Heart Association, the AHA,
actually cashed in, if you can recall, by selling the heart-healthy labels they could put on Rice Krispies and Frosted Flakes, complete junk foods. Believe it or not, from 1970 to 1995, the AHA actually recommended replacing what we know now to be healthy fats with high carbs, high sugar. Literally, snacks like low-fat cookies, unsalted pretzels, jams, and jellies. And as for salt, it was literally one of the most important commodities on the planet over the last 50 centuries. It would be almost impossible to overstate its importance to civilization. So critical was it to health that it was at times used as currency. Roman soldiers were sometimes paid in salt. Life itself depends on salt. Trade routes developed around salt. Ancient civilizations went to great lengths to acquire it. Heck, wars have been waged over this critical mineral compound. Check out this snippet from 1945 in a review of the importance of salt in the American Revolution. Salt was as essential to the armies of 1776 as gasoline is to the armies of 1945. When it was not obtainable, the horses became weak, meats spoiled, and soldiers mutinied. And when pioneers were selecting spots for a new settlement, one of the first questions they asked was, "Where can we get salt?"
So what's all the bad rap about then?
Yeah, well, a combination of things, really. Two important components. One, dirty dealing by the sugar industry, and two, blood pressure theory gone awry. First, in a well-documented scam, big sugar and big food actually paid off respected scientists to fudge research and data in order to downplay sugar's leading role in hypertension and heart disease, and instead to demonize fat and salt. This then paved the way for big government to step in with their low-salt policies. Second was the unsound theory that high dietary salt leads directly to high blood pressure. So remember your ninth grade chemistry experiment on diffusion and equilibrium? When water on one side of the semi-permeable membrane migrated toward the salt side in order to equalize pressures? Well, based on that simple concept, researchers, in an attempt to explain America's mushrooming hypertension problem, assigned blame to salt. Reduce dietary salt, reduce fluid retention, therefore reduce blood pressure. Well, that works in the lab, but not in the body. Far too many complex dynamics and variables. Simply, the kidneys are so efficient at tightly regulating salt balance, excretion, and retention that theory falls apart really quickly. Look, it's the exponential growth of sugar and refined carbs in the diet that drives the metabolic dysfunction and blood pressure issues that are undermining our health today, not salt. There's no definitive evidence supporting salt restriction as a reasonable strategy to treat hypertension. Okay, let's get out of here and finish this up. So what's our takeaway here? First, recognize that hypertension is not a primary disease. It's a symptom, it's a marker, it's a flashing check oil light on your functional health dashboard. Look, high blood pressure is not something you catch. It's, generally speaking, something you earn. It's really one component of a bucket full of physiological imbalances that develop over time. You know, a theme that runs through all of my videos is that no one can approach high-level health by disregarding Mother Nature's fundamental rules. And rule number one, a diet and lifestyle that continually promotes inflammation will eventually catch up to you and break you down. In short, the 1970s ushered in the high-carb, high-sugar, low-fat era of mass food marketing. High-fructose corn syrup was the new lab-created sweetener on the block, and all the big manufacturers jumped on in a big way. This trend also happened to usher in unseen rates of obesity, cardiovascular disease, and kidney disease as well. And the key reason?
the incredible inflammation-producing properties of sugar and refined carbs, on top of the reduction of healthful anti-inflammatory foods like omega-3 rich oils and fats. These then are the conditions that laid the groundwork for the unfounded war on salt. It's an interesting and sort of disturbing story of vested interests and backroom deals. And as always, follow the money for the real story. So humans' need and consumption of salt has remained virtually unchanged for thousands of years. Sugar consumption, on the other hand, has absolutely blown up through the stratosphere. Indeed, the data is horrifying. In the year 1700, consumption is estimated to have been about 4 pounds per person per year. And if you're prone to lightheadedness, please brace yourself. The average person's sugar intake today is about 150 pounds per year. That's a 35x increase. And the biggest consumer of the world? I knew you'd get it. America, the land of processed food, soda, and candy. And take one more guess now at the biggest killer in America and indeed the world. Yep, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, stroke, heart attack. You getting the picture a little bit now? Extreme deprivation will knock a few points off blood pressure readings, but it does come at a significant risk to health. You see, when sodium is severely restricted, blood volume can be reduced by up to 15%. In essence, it causes a dehydration stress. This, in fact, is what lowers the blood pressure. Not healthy. And obviously, all of those serve to magnify our risk for early death. So for assorted reasons, health authorities, government, mainstream media seem to continue to embrace disproven theories on salt. So until the nonsense low-salt dogma is scrapped and people finally embrace the truth about the body's incredible innate capacity to function optimally and heal and thrive given the opportunity, that is to say, whole food, diet, exercise, fresh air, sunlight, and so forth, will continue to struggle with chronic degenerative diseases of all sorts, overprescription of pharmaceuticals, colossal overutilization of the Western medical sickness care model. Finally, there will be a small percentage of people with genetic predisposition to problems with salt. But the overarching point here is that almost all of the common health challenges we face are preventable through diet, lifestyle. I've gone through it many times in videos. Please check those out. I hope you do. Blood pressure problems, obesity, insulin resistance, diabetes, heart attacks, heart problems, all of that stuff. That's all preventable by adopting healthy lifestyle and following Mother Nature's foundational rules. In other words, by taking responsibility for our own health, thereby keeping that away from the medical machine that will take you in and chew you up. So wrapping up, links in the description as usual. Thanks so much for watching my vids. As always, till we see you again, yours in vibrant health, Dr. J.